Hello everyone, I am Dr. Uma Charlata, Head Department of Commerce of Anaival at Arts and Science College. I am happy to welcome you all for today's webinar session on economic impact of COVID-19. As we could find more participants are joining with us, until then, let me share an insight of our institution. Our institution was incepted in the year 1997 and it's a core education institution, which is located at Ambattur. It is managed by Resaratnam Educational Trust. At present, we are in the second cycle of NAC accreditation, and it's also an ISO 9001:2015 certified institution. Our motto is to seek, strive, and succeed. Our vision is to mold our students to be intellectual, compatible, socially responsible, professionally capable, and foster research, innovations, and entrepreneurial attitude to face challenges. Our mission is also to emphasize on holistic education, to enhance moral values, to encourage innovations and creativity in young minds, and to face a competitive world about the management. Our institution is headed by our chairman, Dr. Enna Dhanabalan, who is a philanthropist, social activist, politician, and an educationist. Also, we have young and dynamic secretary, Mr. N.R.D. Prem Kumar, and Joint Secretary, Dr. P.R. Premchand, who is a great educationist and always a mentor and guide. Now, as our speaker is about to join, let me share a video. Now, as speaker has joined us, now before we proceed to the main session, it's a request from our side to the participants to kindly subscribe the channel and press notification symbol for further updations, and also to register your questions in chat box. So now I invite our beloved principal, Dr. Kamala Balakrishnan, for welcome address.
Good morning all. On behalf of Anaival Arts and Science College, I extend a warm welcome to all participants for today's webinar on economic impact of the COVID-19. This webinar series is an initiative by the IQAZ of Annaivalet Arts and Science College to engage students in this lockdown period. We all think whether we can lead a life before COVID-19. Things will never be the same again. Let's be clear about it. COVID-19 will change the way the world works, just like the Great Depression, dot-com bubble, and the 2008 financial crash. The question on everyone's mind is, will things go back to normal? I have been thinking, like many have, what fundamental changes will take place in how people and business and economic function in this crisis. The next 12 months will be difficult for many business cycles. Some business even may die. But economic advisories of the past, new industries will emerge, bringing with it and renewed hope of recovery. Eventually, things will go back to normal. I would like to quote Ratan Tata's, like, in past difficult times, entrepreneurs have displayed far-sightedness and creativity that would not have been believed to exist. These became flagpoles of innovation and new technology today. This crisis will force entrepreneurs to adapt and create new things. Today, with us, we have a special resource person, expert, Dr. Thirunavukkarasu, president for Center for Economic Development Studies. And he is the right person to enlighten us about this topic, economic impact of the COVID-19. Welcome, sir. I hope this session will be useful and eye-opener for us. I take this opportunity to thank our management as well as team members, faculty members of Annaivalet Arts and Science College and all the participants from our college as well as other colleges. Welcome you all. Over to Dr. Uma Charlatha.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, I request Dr. Radha, Head PG and Research Department of Commerce, to introduce our today's speaker.
A very pleasant morning to one and all. On behalf of the IQAZ and Department of Commerce and Economics, it gives me a great pleasure for me to introduce our chief guest for today's session, Dr. S. Thirunavukkarasu, who is going to talk to us about the economic impact of COVID-19. Sir has been in teaching, research, and educational administration for more than 3 decades. He has guided 20 PhD scholars and published more than 70 articles, and he has done 12 projects for the World Bank, UGC, etc. He has served as a member of Board of Studies to many colleges, chairman of Board of Studies, member and chairman of Academic Council, and syndicate member and senate member in case of University of Madras. And currently, Dr. S. Thirunavukkarasu is the founder president for the Center for Development of Economic Studies. Once again, on behalf of the IKAZ of Annaivalet College, I welcome you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. As life is short and time is fast, let us focus today on economic impact of COVID-19. Now, I hand over the session to our distinguished speaker of today, Dr. Thirunavukkarasu, sir. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, all of you. Chevalier Dr. N.R. Dhanabalan, Chairman, Mr. N.R.D. Prem Kumar, Secretary, Dr. B.E.R. Premchand, Joint Secretary, Dr. Kamala Balakrishnan, Principal, Mr. J.P.R. Solomon, Vice Principal, IQAC Coordinator. Is it audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And members of IQAC, and my dear webinar participants, good morning, all of you.
Sir, can you maximize that window, sir?
My window?
Yeah, yes, sir. It works.
Sir, you can proceed, sir. Even if you are comfortable, you can proceed.
It's okay?
Yeah, yes, sir.
It's not enlarging at all. this country. Now it's okay?
Yes, sir. Now it's okay, sir.
Now it's okay. Good morning, all of you. Really, I am thankful to Annai Violet Arts and Science College for having given this opportunity to share my views on the impact of COVID on Indian economy. As we all experience what is happening around, which is special now, which is new to us, and especially youngsters, they will be maybe difficult, maybe understanding, maybe a lot of issues pertaining to disturbance in their normal life. This is on one side. On the other side, if you take the whole world in account, world is a global village. And we are all part of this global village. When something happens in one place, automatically it disturbs other places too. This is being proved by COVID-19, because people say it originated somewhere, entered into many countries, and disturbed many of us. We cannot pinpoint a particular country or a region for the spread of this particular virus, because there is no scientific evidence and proof to pinpoint a particular point. So taking that into account, since we are part of the global village, we have to be part of anything that comes. When we are happy to get commodities from worldwide, we have to be same way to understand when something comes, we have to bear with that. So taking this into account, in those days, world economies, especially in the international trade, we have been following protectionism. And the protectionism was there for some period. Later on, people started accepting free trade. When free trade entered into the system, people started using the abundance and the benefits of free trade. In the free trade, countries which have beneficial in certain industries, they are producing at a cheaper cost and export to other countries. And countries which are not, such commodities are not available, they are able to import at a cheaper cost. Therefore, it actually facilitated the international trade. In the international trade, many countries are on the advantage position. Some countries, they are in the disadvantaged position, and this is all mostly economic point of view. In this scenario, probably in India, government thought that we are not doing well in certain areas. Therefore, many research have been done and started concentrating on various sectors to improve our economic system. Probably during 1990, when Mr. Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister, he promulgated the new economic policy. You know about the details of the economic policy. It contains globalization, liberalization, and privatization. If we take the first one, globalization, automatically we are part of the global system. When something happening there, it will impact us, whether this is on production side or on any other devastation side or the pandemic disease like COVID, etc. After the introduction of the new economic policy, India was growing better compared to the pre-globalization period and the post-globalization period. India is performing well in terms of exports, and also import also increased. The standard of living has improved. Many people, especially educated, they started moving from India to foreign countries. India receives so much of foreign exchange reserves to our side. These are all positive side of globalization. But all the new economic policy put together it actually changed the whole economic system. For example, during the post new economic policy era, it was really 1960, you can see the data, our GDP growth rate was 3.72% in 30 years. So 1990, I have sorted the number of data. 1990, it was 5.53%. In 1991, it was 1.06%. And this 1991 low GDP growth rate forced the government of India to think about the new economic policy. Automatically, from 1991 onwards, the growth has begun and India is able to do something and other countries start looking at us, especially in the industrial scenario. In 2000, again, there was a shortfall in the GDP growth rate to 3.84%. In 2015, we have reached 7.41%. In 2019, 3.4%. 2020, they say there may be about 0.2 or 0.3% reduction. You are able to see the growth in the pre-new economic policy era. Again, furtherance of growth after, that is post-new economic policy era. So what we have achieved, now it is in a big question mark because of what is happening around. If you look at the countries in the account, normally we divide the economies into developed and developing. Later, they have divided into emerging market and developing economies, and then advanced economies. These are all the two broad categories that the World Bank follows. India is in the emerging market and developing economies. We are in the better position among the countries. Last year, we have recorded 6.98% growth rate. And it is a remarkable performance at the international level. And many countries, they started comparing India and China. We are able to do better in certain areas, but in several areas, China is in advantage position. There are so many reasons for why India is not able to cope up with certain areas when compared to China. This is a debatable point. And then, if you look at the overall economic scenario, probably in 1970s, India was ahead of China. Whereas in 2020, we just look at the overall position, we cannot say we are ahead of China, especially in the exports and foreign exchange earnings. These are all number of reasons for this particular poor situation in certain areas. And then the budgetary position of Indian government. India is doing well after the demonetization. There was some problem in the overall system. Now we started gaining from that and we are doing better. But the fiscal deficit and other types of deficit like revenue deficit and et cetera, there are some problems. The fiscal deficit is around 5.8% of GDP, so which is an alarming rate. And then the revenue deficit area also, there is a wider gap. There are some issues in the industrial growth. There are issues in other sectors also. All put together, India was struggling for some time, but we are regaining our growth and other countries started looking at us, why and how India is able to do well with so much of population. So we are the second largest in terms of population. With all this, we are able to do better with our own inherent power and system. In the midst, probably in the last week of January 2020, COVID entered into India and made our country into a lot of problems. It started with only one person entering with COVID positive. Initially, all the state governments, with the direction of the union government, started controlling the menace of COVID by way of number of preventive measures. Initially, the growth was minimum only, but later on, it is on exponential growth. And government has no other option to stop the spread of COVID. So what are the steps that the government has taken? Lockdown, what we are all experiencing, and we are speaking from home only. And they are suggesting number of measures to stop the spread of COVID, like social distancing, sanitization, hand wash with the soap. And after the COVID-19 issues are over, and what we have done so far, like the social distancing, sanitization, and hand wash with soap. So this practice may have to continue, they say, because this will not go permanently. Some people say, let us not fear about COVID-19 because it is yet another virus only. It will be part of our human system. Once our immunity develops to this particular virus, then we are able to have our own immunity level to tackle the spread of COVID-19. So many days of lockdown, and then how government is able to control the lockdown with so much of population, that we have to praise both the union government and the state government. There are some issues, but even at home, we may be 3 or 4 people, we are unable to control our children. Then think about the government. We are more than 135 crore people. How a government will control each and everyone, especially during lockdown, when whether there are some needs to buy commodities or for anything else at home. Now there is no transport and we are idle at home, work from home, we study from home, online classes are going on for schools and then colleges, and then webinar like this is going on normally, seminar like this, we used to go to the colleges, go to the seminar and share the views. Now we are on webinar and sharing our views, and unknown people, they may be watching our talk, and the known people may be also listening to our talk, etc. Apart from this, gaming by the children, new dishes at home, eating more, taking rest, and landing in health issues also. Now all these things in the account, if analyze how we are and where we are and what will happen after the COVID is over, what will happen to the Indian economy, what will happen to the global economies, all put together, I feel there are chances of deglobalization. Because in 1990, when new economic policy was brought in, they have promulgated globalization. They have broken the age-old protectionism, safeguarding their own country. And they have brought globalization and promulgated a country into a global village. But now, there is a talk about deglobalization, because each country will try to protect its own people. Then what will happen in the path of deglobalization that we may have to witness and see? In the deglobalization era, how best we can prepare ourselves and what we can do, that another important issue, again, is a debatable point. And then, viruses, it entered into the global system. It came to India also. It affected many people. The number is increasing. And we are all struggling with that. And the government, health department, police personnel, and other security departments, they are all working round the clock to help the people, to provide safety to the people, and to provide all facilities to the people. And this virus, if you go back to the old ancient system, they say it is a wrath of gods. Ancient studies have said, they have believed, the inflicted disease is only out of their own curse. It is only unscientific, we cannot prove it. This is a belief in those days. And then Justinian plague. Actually, this plague originated from northern part of India, China, and then entered into Egypt, and then Byzantine Empire and Mediterranean ports, etc. And this also made the beginning of dark ages in those days. But in those days, even though it is unscientific, people believe that such viruses or pathogens, whatever it is only out of curse. And then import of disease. Normally we think about or talk about import of commodities. Now it is import of diseases. The import of diseases, we have a number of records of importing diseases from many countries for many centuries. We have a record that I'll show you in the next table. When the disease enters into a country, the first thing they do is preventive measures. One of the preventive measures is quarantine. As per the record, they say it even happened in 14th century, and especially in Venice, when the new ship comes, they have to anchor it for 40 days. So even in those days, there was quarantine. And during cholera outbreak in 1854, Dr. John Snow, he found that it is out of tainted water. The tainted water is responsible for the outbreak of cholera. And then he made data directory map where it comes. Cluster-based study was done in those days to identify where it breaks and how it can be controlled. So in 1854 itself, there was a discussion about how the cluster level approach can be followed to tackle this particular thing. And then we have tracking of infectiousness, where it is originating, how many people are susceptible to such diseases, and how to control the menace of any virus. There's another tackling issues. Then who is responsible and what factor is responsible for the growth of such viruses? They say one of the reasons is urbanization. Urbanization is expanding like anything. Many small towns have become cities. Cities have become metropolitan area. And many areas have brought into the clutches of the larger agglomeration of the cities. And this urbanization also attracts many diseases due to sanitary and then other health hazards. So taking these four, five factors into account, the viruses, how old the days people thought about it, how to track it, why urbanization is responsible for the outbreak of such viruses. Again, we have to analyze in toto to get a solution to solve any such things. So I have divided this lecture into four parts. History of pandemic, theories of epidemic diseases, COVID-19 and preventive measures worldwide, impact of COVID-19 on Indian economy. So these are all the four major heads I have dissected this study, this talk. In the history of pandemics, the entire list I have given here, starting from 165 to 180 time period. The first one is Antonine plague. They say, believed to be either smallpox or measles, it killed about 5 million people. So list is more. And then the disease that, which killed 200 million people was Black Death. It happened during 1347 and 1351. Yersinia pestis, bacteria, rats, fleas, etc. Another one which killed about 1 lakh people is in 1665, Great Plague of London. And then 12 million people in China, India, which was third plague, which occurred in 1885. Yersinia pestis, bacteria, rats, fleas. And then Spanish flu, 1918 to 1990, it killed about 40 to 50 million people. And then Ebola virus 2014-16, which killed about 11,000 people. MERS in 2015 till date, more than 850 people. COVID-19, which started in 2019, and the data I'll give you a bit later. So taking all these viruses which enter into the countries have killed lakhs and lakhs of people. If you look at the list of all these viruses, there are vaccines for all these viruses, but vaccines are yet to be developed for certain viruses, which is a scientific one. But India is a pioneer in controlling certain diseases. I just remember in my school days, maybe about 50 years ago, in the villages we used to run because the local doctors used to come to villages for giving injections for vaccines. The schools or in the villages we used to run. But that vaccine made us to withstand the attack of all these viruses. Even in India, in the cities or in the rural areas, after the birth, the children is given with a table chart, and mother or parents, they take them for injection periodically, and that helps India somehow to withstand the attack of COVID-19. Compared to the European countries, USA and other countries, even though the number is beyond 72,000 in India, but the death rate is minimum compared to the advanced countries because they are not following the vaccination method of what we follow here. And this vaccination actually helped India somehow to withstand the attack of COVID-19. And then if you trace the history, the plague, how it attacked India and when it attacked, say in 1911, 1912, in India about 73,000 people died out of plague. It entered into many parts of our country. And we have data for Tamil Nadu. In Salem, reported case 1898, number of death 13,312. In Madras city, first reported case 1905, number of death 78. To control a plague, they have established quarantine houses. That was the history. They have made quarantine houses separately and put all the people in the quarantine houses and they gave medicine to cure the diseases. Spanish flu, 10 to 12 million people have died. And these are all some of the records available about the attack of plague and the Spanish flu on our country and how we solved it. The entire thing is given in the picture. The theories of epidemic diseases. So before we take into the effect of viruses, what people, they study and give their opinion on how this epidemic diseases disturb the people. I have listed many studies about 15 or 16 studies worldwide. What they generally tell is, one thing is preventive behavior, disease prevalence, economic causes and pandemic consequences, and then disease transmission mechanism, and then population into compartments, control reproduction, disease management, behavioral responses, individual rationality, individual choices, government intervention, optimally allocated health authorities, health policies, medical treatment of infected and outbreak control, capacity of the country to deal with it, disrupt economic and social valuable activity. These are all some of the studies analyzing about the immunization process and how it affected people. This is the first time information given by these scholars about how viruses or pathogens disturb the human being, how individuals have overcome the difficulties, and what are the suggestions to come out from this particular menace. This is about the crux of the studies report given by the people. And then COVID-19 and preventive measures worldwide. If we take this particular COVID-19, worldwide countries are affected, there's no doubt. And what about the communicable and the non-communicable diseases? How World Health Organization, my son says, if I'm taking much time, it's 20 minutes is over. So World Health Organization, and what are the measures taken by different health organization, state government and central government, etc. NCD, non-communicable diseases. In the non-communicable diseases, 63% of death occurs globally due to this. And this is affecting more in low and middle income countries, which account for 80% of the total NCD death. And then adding to this NCD, now COVID has come. And for the COVID, we are not exposed to it. It's a new virus, even though it is there in the 12th book. But this virus, we are only, now only we are experiencing. Therefore, World Health Organization declared this as the public health emergency of international concern. They have declared as a pandemic disease on March 11th, 2020. Even though it originated in 2019, but the World Health Organization started declaring this as an emergency of pandemic only on March 11, 2020. So this difference between December 19 and March 11, 2020, they started spreading to various countries. And then World Health Organization also provides guidelines to all the countries. In the guidelines, what we have to do, and then what are the steps the government has to take, and these are all given in the guidelines. Let us not discuss in detail about it. It's available in the website. And as per today's record, COVID worldwide has killed 2,78,993 people, and there are about 40,13,728 confirmed cases. People say it is growing on exponential rate. It is being proved. It started with one in India, now it is around 72,000. So it is growing alarmingly. We have to be very, very careful. And then, what is the link between NCD and this COVID-19? Why NCD and COVID-19 we have to give importance? Because people who have NCD, they are susceptible to the attack of COVID easily. Because in India, about 1.3 million people are with diabetics and hypertension. So the number is more. Therefore, the attack may be more if we don't take proper precautionary measures. And then, transformational impact on economic health, social, psychological, and geopolitical situation. this will be more when the demographic profile health education level of a country is less. For example, what I say demographic profile, if you look at the countries, some countries will have more old age population, some countries will have working population, some countries will have more children. If you look at the demographic profile of India, we have more of working population and lesser percentage of old age, that is above 60 like us, and then children below 14 years. Even though it is advantage to any country, when we have more working population, the growth will be better. And similarly, when the country has more old age population, the attack disease will be more. We are able to see in the European countries how old age people are suffering. But we cannot say that this is not, COVID-19 will not affect youngsters also. It is affecting children also. Even the infant are being affected by COVID-19 as per the records we have seen in the newspaper. So taking all these points into account, the preventive measures taken by world countries, starting from NCD and then COVID-19 and how they go about, these are all the points that we have so far discussed. Worldwide policy measures, monetary measures, fiscal policy measure, public health measure, human control measure, these are all the four broad measures taken by various countries. Regulatory leniency, India, Ireland. Regulatory leniency means what banks to do pertaining to principal or interest moratorium on debtors. And then lowering interest rate by central bank. This is done by India, Turkey, US, etc. Sustain the flow of credit bank. It is done by India, Australia, Nigeria, US, etc. So in monetary policy, in India, we have chosen the first one, regulatory leniency to banks, and then moratorium to debtors, lowering interest rate by central bank, and then sustained flow of credit to banks, SMEs, public sector health, and then individuals and essential businesses. So these are all monetary measures taken by India and the rest of other countries. Fiscal policy measures, it includes government stimulus package, income support for individual, social welfare support to households, taken by India and then US, Australia, UK, etc. So these are all the fiscal measures. Well, let us not discuss in detail because it will take more time. And then public health measure, in which we have public quarantine, border quarantine, stay-at-home measures, social distancing method. It is followed by India and the rest of other countries also. And then human control measures like closing of air, land and sea borders, closing of schools, colleges, offices, industries, using of military to control the growth, travel ban, visa suspension. These are all the human control measures taken by most of the countries. But we have not chosen using of military to control. It is chosen by Malaysia, Italy, Israel, South Africa and Spain. And the other three points, that is closing of air, etc., closing of schools, travel ban, visa suspension, India is adopting. And then current stimulus packages worldwide, because the stimulus package given by other countries also impact our country. What are the stimulus package they give? For example, Germany, France, Italy, Japan, UK, USA, they are giving stimulus packages to industries and also to individuals. The list is more. It is given there. It is available in the website also. Some of the important things are Canada. They spend about $27 billion direct support to retained employees, that is giving income to the employees, and then 7.5% wage subsidy for firms, and then 30% revenue drop. This is given to the industries. And then direct income support. For the jobless, they are giving $200 per month for 4 months, $1,250 per month for 4 months to recent graduates, and then self-employed part-time workers. So like that, some countries, they follow novel policies and to help the people not to come out of their home, to follow 100% lockdown in order to avoid the spread of COVID. This is the reason for quoting what other countries are doing to control the growth of COVID. The stimulus package done by other countries will be a role model to countries like India. And then, now, its impact on Indian economy. What we have done so far is historical and then the current scenario of how world countries are able to control, prevent, and help the people, etc., etc., in the previous slides. And we have mentioned about what India is taking efforts in controlling COVID in the form of monetary policy, fiscal policy, and then public health policy, etc. And taking that into account, dissecting into various minute points, we have about 4 or 5 pages. In just 10 minutes, I will finish it. Impact of COVID, how it impacted our India. Normally, the impact will be on various sectors. When something comes, we think about from where it comes, how it will change us, whether this will affect our system, what will happen to the country when this is expanding. So anybody in the higher level, they think about it. Especially the policy makers will analyze what will happen due to some particular issues. Now the issue before the government is COVID, how to tackle it, how to solve the problem arising out of COVID-19. And we know, as an individual, we know who are all will be affected and how it is affecting the people. When they are affected, some remedy must be given. The remedies are given by various countries. We have listed in the previous slide, different packages given to industries and then individuals. Similarly, what we are doing in our country with respect to its impact. Normally, in the system, in any economic system that matter, any new, say, virus like COVID-19 enters, what our government is doing to control it? What are the sectors it is going to affect? So this is being done here. So this is given in the form of imports, exports, foreign exchange, sector-wise impact, various sectors into account, and then gainers, top gainers, top losers. So these are all the points that we have to discuss in this particular area. The first one, imports. The impact of COVID on import, impact of COVID on exports. On imports, study says it is going to reduce 43% on export and then 34% on import. They say the impact is more on exports and lesser on imports. Because we continue to import from foreign countries. Why it is impacting less on import and more on exports? Another study by Du and Bradstreet, they say GDP will be down by 0.3 percentage point in the current period, and it will be around 4.88%, they have estimated. Last year we were around 5 point something, now it will be around 4.8%. Next year they project there will be 0.5% and we may reach 6%. They say next year it may grow, the GDP may grow. And then in the import, how this this is going to influence. They say in the imports, we import defense equipment, consumer product, heavy machineries, etc., etc. In the list of imports, the major import is from China. That is the core point that we have discussed here. China, they are the worldwide exporter and importer. For example, to the world, they export 13% and they import 11%. If you look at our position, probably in 1700, in the total world trade, India's contribution was 27%. In 1700, the total world trade, India's contribution was 27%. Whereas now, it is not even 2%. Over a period of 320 years, our export has declined from 27% to just 2% in the total world trade. Whereas if you look at China, to the world trade, they export 13% and import only 11%. 2% they have advantage in the export and import. And that comes in the form of foreign exchange, more and more foreign exchange. Even they can challenge any country because they have so much of abundance of foreign exchange. In the various industry level, electronic, machinery, organic chemicals, automotive parts, fertilizers, and then mobile phones. These are all the major imports that we do from China. You just look at the data. Electronic import account for 45%. The total import of electronic item is 45%. That is only from one country, that is China. 1/3 of machinery we import from China. 2/5 of organic chemicals from China. 25% of automotive parts and fertilizer from China. 65-70% of pharmaceutical ingredients. We say we are number one in the export of pharma products, but we procure raw material for this from China, which is 65-70%. 90% of certain mobile phones imported from China. So we totally rely on China in these major import items. You just think about the Indian industries, depending on this product, they will be affected in the future due to deglobalization that I have mentioned earlier. And then in exports, we're exporting to USA, European countries, Gulf countries, African countries, etc. But again, in the export, India, the third largest exporter with the 5% share to China. What are all the product we export to China? Organic chemicals, plastics, fish product, cotton, oats, etc. 72% of Indian companies, they have business establishment in southern part of China. And they are manufacturing IT and the BPO, logistics, chemicals, airlines, and tourism. So taking export and import, in the export, we rely on China. And also in the import, we rely more on China. In the import, we more rely on China. In export, around 5% we rely on China. And then in the foreign exchange, if you take the total remittances of 2019, it is around $83 billion. In current year, it is estimated $64 billion. And estimated drop is around 23%. So compared to 2019 to 2020, that the foreign exchange may drop by 23%. Why it is going to drop? Because people, our Indians who are working in foreign countries, they are slowly packing to come back to India, and especially migrant workers, and then other type of workers, not a permanent citizen, other type of workers in those countries, they are preferring to come back to our country. When they work there, they bring foreign currency, foreign exchange. When they come here, we'll be losing foreign exchange. And that accounts for, it is estimated, around 23%. And once the situation is over, the same thing may be totally different one. Sector-wise impact, we've just seen how the import sector and export sector are being affected by COVID. And then sector-wise impact, labor market is affected. When the labor will return back to duty, it is again a big question mark. When they return back to the duty, how would social distancing we have to maintain? Even if colleges are open, it will be a problem to us, because in a class we may be accommodating 60 to 70 boys as per the norms. When social distancing is required, then UGC will be giving us what to follow there. They may not allow more than 35 boys to sit in the class. So we have to divide the classes into two sections. So like that, the labor market, laborers are scattered, laborers are disturbed, laborers are sitting under lockdown. And when they are going to return back, and what is the problem pertaining to migrant worker? And we are able to see in the last 3-4 days how railway stations and other places are so highly crowded to make the people to go home. And when they go home, they may carry virus also. Then it will again spread more. So the labor market, it is a big area where the government has to concentrate. And what is the stimulus package that the government is going to pay? We have to watch and become probably by tomorrow, day after, the government is going to announce the second stimulus package. And we have to see how they are going to compensate for the labor force. Another important area where it is disturbing is supply chain. The supply chain, the entire Indian economy is interwoven. We cannot say I am from Tamil Nadu or from Kashmir. Certain products come from Kashmir to Tamil Nadu. Some product moves from Tamil Nadu to Kashmir. So, Kanyakumari to Kashmir, we have all the sectors interwoven. Products, they move, raw materials, they move from one place to another place and come in the form of final product. So, supply chain will be affected once the lockdown is removed. The supply chain may be again evolved back. Then what about the businesses? FICCI and the tax consultants, Dhruva, they have analyzed about 360 business establishment, and they say all the businesses are grappling tremendous uncertainty. According to their study, 70% of surveyed firms found degrowth sales. There is fall in the sales, if we can see very well. There is fall in the sales. But according to their study, it is 75% reduction in the growth of sales. Their study says that 61% of respondents says postpone such expansion. Expansion may not be there. That is given by 61% of 380 companies. And they will postpone to 6 to 12 months. So after 1 year, there will be no further expansion by these industries. And then fundraising plans. They may not do this as opened by 60% of the companies, and they are going to postpone it by 6 to 12 months. So next 12 months, these companies have no fundraising plans. And then pharma, chemicals, electronic business is affected by around 10%. So in the business, we're able to see from the record, not by data, government data or other data, it is a study. They say expansion will be a problem, fundraising will be a problem, and then supply chain, about 10% cut in all these. So business will be affected by this. So chemical industry, we rely on China, 20% we import from China. So Indian chemical industries will be affected. Shipping industry, they say 75 to 80% dry bulk trade will be reduced due to problem due to COVID. especially in the shipping industry. Auto industry, they say 8 to 10% contraction due to importing problem of automotive parts from China. Pharmaceutical industry, drug exports will be affected and bulk drugs prices may go up. They say this pertaining to pharmaceutical industry. Textile industry, textile factories are closed. Once they resume the work, laborers have to come from different places. And now they are moving out from Tamil Nadu to other places. How the textile industries, they are going to have labor from locally, and it may, the wages may increase and the cost of production may go up. Solar power sector, we rely on China for solar power. And again, solar power industry will be affected. Electronic industry also will be affected because we rely on China for raw material. IT industry also affected. Tourism and aviation will also be affected due to lockdown. So these are all the sectors affected by COVID-19. So the data and all we have just discussed about it. Taking all these 13 sectors into account, so I have divided into losers due to COVID, like in the market, the losers and gainers. And overall losers in the COVID-19, apparel, textile, automobile, auto parts, aviation, tourism, shipping and non-food retail, building and construction, banking, financial services, infrastructure, health sector, corporate sector, restaurant business, sports industry, event industry, entertainment industry, MSMEs, e-commerce industry, stock market, agriculture. So all these sectors will be losers due to COVID-19. So we have a lot of points in this. It will take more than 1 hour to explain how these sectors are on the loser side. Then we have gainers, overall gainers, digital internet economy. We are using internet, so they are one of the gainers. Online education, online skill development, online groceries, online vegetables. So digital marketing, internet marketing is doing well. They are the gainers. Fast moving consumer goods, FMCG, and retail. And then specialty chemicals like disinfectants, drugs and medicines, and then pharmaceuticals. These are all the major sectors who are all in the gainers list. Stimulus package given by the government. So we have seen the gainers as well as losers. If you look at the list of losers and gainers, gainers are less and losers are more. And to support the losers, government, ADB, World Bank, and other international agencies, they are supporting our India in the form of package measures. World Bank approved $1 billion emergency financing for India for this particular COVID alone. Government of India released 17,287 crores, two different states. Ministry of Home Affairs approved 11,092 crores for various states. 30% cut in salary taken by Government of India, starting from President and then Vice President, Prime Minister, Governors, Members of Parliament, Ministers, etc. States are allowed for net market borrowing up to ₹3,20,481 crores. And then Prime Minister Garib Kalyan Yojana sanctioned about ₹3,000 crore, 20 million workers will be benefited. Relief to taxpayers up to 18,000 crores. Asian Development Bank assured 15,800 crores rupees. RBI announced 50,000 crores to NABARD, SIDBI, and NHB. Shanghai Cooperation Organization, Chinese based, agreed upon joint road bank for economic recovery with India. Again, ADB approved 10,500 crores relief package to loan to India. So these are all actual. Government of India, World Bank, and then other ADB-like company, ADB-like organizations gave financial assistance to countries. Yesterday, Prime Minister was talking to all the chief ministers, and then we are expecting a relief. They listed in the relief in sight. What are the relief which is projected? Liquidity credit support for MSMEs, credit guarantee for working capital loans, credit support for first-time borrowers, and then wage support for MSMEs, some form of assistance to support the jobs, support package for migrants, variant of direct benefit transfer, DBT on cards, incentive to companies to maintain jobs. So these are all the major areas that the government may give some relief, which government may be releasing shortly. So taking all these into account, the impact of COVID on Indian economy, it is there. It is severely affected our country. It shattered all the countries worldwide. And the post-COVID-19, 2019, will be a big lesson. We have learned a big lesson out of this COVID-19. And if you actually recollect whether what we are doing is correct or not, how we supported the government, and how government is struggling to help us to control the spread of menace. If we put our introspection, then we will come to understand whether we are in the right path or not. As individual, how we have cooperated with the government. On the one side, we are criticizing the government. On the other side, we have to cooperate with the government. Unless we cooperate, no policy will be successful. Lockdown means it should be 100%. If it is 100%, then there will be no physical touch. Automatically, the spread of COVID will be controlled. Once the spread is controlled, automatically you will be safe. Then you will become immune to any new virus. And in the future, we are able to do well. And I thank Madam Kamala Balakrishnan, Dr. Kamala Balakrishnan, and the management of Annai Violet College, and then IQAC team. It seems I remember I came during your first NAC preparation, perhaps after a long time. I got the chance of again sharing my view. I thank Principal Madam, and thank the management, and thank all of you, Rajeshwari Madam, and then Ivanesh Kumar sir, and then Dr. Radha Madam, and then Uma Madam. And I thank one and all. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your informative and impressive presentation. So as quoted by Helen Keller, well-educated mind will have more questions than answer. With this quote in our mind, let's move on to our question and answer session. So we've been receiving questions from the participants. And the first question is, with the moratorium that has been extended by banks for 3 months, is it advisable for people to take it or pay upfront or monthly regularly? Your answer, sir?
It all depends upon the individual financial position. When the moratorium is given, if you use it according to the financial position of the individual, they can avail the benefit. Otherwise, if they have money, they can pay back. But anyhow, whether we pay today or tomorrow, we have to pay back to the government. When it comes in the form of moratorium, it is advantage to the people. It will be gain if they don't pay.
Yes, sir. The next question is, why have US equities underperformed their global counterparts?
Pardon?
Why have US equities underperformed their global counterparts?
Because it is affected in the every country, but especially in the stock market, if you analyze, due to any reason, suddenly stock market may, the volatility will be there. For example, when there is a rain, when there is no rain, stock market will be affected. Due to COVID, it's a known reason. So people, they have fears. Some countries, they may withdraw. That is the another major problem of foreign direct investment, because when they say that, the people will say, when I invest, I should gain. When they feel that it is not going to help them, they will withdraw. Automatically, this will affect the stock market. When many people sell, when many people buy, this demand and supply will change automatically. With the SEBI rules, the prices may go up or decrease. So it's a normal one. And due to this COVID, it is disturbing our stock market. Once the COVID situation changes, many people from India and abroad, they'll come back and invest in our stock market.
Thank you, sir. Next question, how FMCG and consumable durable sector will move during this tough time?
Consumer durable, I think this sector will not be affected much, because the essential commodities, only for a certain period they were closed. Now they started resuming the work, and shortly, even now, I don't think they are not available in the market. They are available, but it is available in a limited number. Once they resume the production, automatically commodities will be available in the market, and this will not affect much. Maybe it's only a short-term problem.
So next question, after COVID-19, will there be many industrial opportunities, sir?
Yeah, especially this COVID-19 disturbed a lot, shattered the whole industry. The industry in the sense, either on the production side or in the service side, they are totally affected by COVID-19. But what I feel, some international changes, scenario changes, I predict, because many countries, they may look our country, they look our country, because we have certain positive factors. Normally Indians, we receive people and we respect people. I presume many foreign companies will come to India, and industrial growth will be still better in the future. That's what I predict.
And next question, sir, what will be the unemployment employment opportunities due to this unemployment scenario?
The employment and the unemployment level is increasing now. Once industries resume the work, automatically employment level will increase. Once the employment level increases, automatically unemployment rate will decrease. And this employment and the industrial growth, they are positively and proportionately related. Normally in economics, we say only when there is employment, due to the chain of causation, there will be abundant growth in the economy. So unemployment, it is there. But once this lockdown is over and the industry resumes work, and when many new industries emerges into our country, automatically an employment will be more.
Okay, sir. And the last question, can you give any suggestion as to recover from this bigger loss which our country is undergoing due to this COVID-19?
So what I feel is, any policy should be people-centric, because the epicenter of any disease is only human being, and we have to be very careful. We have to safeguard ourselves, and we have to cooperate with the government. We have to cooperate with the neighbors. We should be part of our social system. And as a human being, and we have to take care of the neighbors also, and therefore cooperation and coordination would result in the prosperity and the growth of any country.
And one more last question, sir. GDP production is bad and reserves are improving due to favorable crude prices. What will be the next index for the quality of Indian economy?
So GDP growth rate, it is declining. As we say, in the last 5-6 years, it is decreasing. And it is decreasing because of corrective measures, starting from demonetization. And then the several corrective measures taken by the Union government. So it shattered some industries. It is a normal thing. Any corrective measures taken by the government will impact on the industries. It is only for a good thing. Once the corrective measures is achieved, automatically the real system will emerge. When the real system emerges, then the productivity will increase. Once the production, the industry, agriculture, and other sectors increases, automatically GDP level will increase.
Thank you, sir, for your crystal clear explanation. And definitely, after the post-lockdown period, our country will face a big challenge to come make its comeback. So now we are end of the session. Before we end, information to the participants, kindly fill the feedback and submit through the link displayed in chat box before 3 p.m. today to generate your e-certificates. Now, Mrs. Rajeshwari, Head Department of Corporate Secretaryship, is joining us to propose a vote of thanks.
Give thanks for a little and you will find a lot. Good afternoon all. It's my privilege to render this vote of thanks on behalf of Annaviolet Arts and Science College to all who helped us in making this webinar a great success. I thank the God Almighty for his blessings showered on this day. I express my profound gratitude to our management, our chairman, Dr. Chevalier N.R. Dhanapalan sir, our secretary, Mr. N.R.D. Premkumar sir, and joint secretary, Dr. P.E.R. Premchand sir, for giving us an opportunity to conduct this webinar. My sincere thanks to our principal, Dr. Kamala Balakrishnan ma'am, who has organized this event and who is the backbone of this webinar. I thank our vice principal and IQAC coordinator, Mrs. Jafia Solomon ma'am, for her motivation and continuous support. My heartfelt thanks to our speaker, Dr. S. Thirunavakar sir, for his excellent presentation. Thank you, sir, for your thought-provoking session. Your thoughts has given the confidence that we can overcome this as we did in the past with the help of our government policies. We have also come to know about the industries which will grow well in the future. I thank our technical team who are working behind the screen and helping us throughout. Finally, I thank the head of the departments, staff and students of our college and all the virtual participants from other colleges and from various parts of our country like Uttarakhand, Ayodhya, Bangalore, Banaras, Hoshiarpur, etc. for the enthusiastic participation. Thank you one and all.
Thank you all once again.